coming to Fondren Presbyterian Church on this New Year's Day. We're so happy that those of you who are here decided to come worship with us today. I kind of want to do something radical. I'm wondering if I could get some of the people in the back to move up a little bit closer so that we're, you know, a little bit more centered. I'm not going to make you. I'm just saying, if you will, I'll move up some. So. We don't want to make Cassie feel wrong.
Thank you.
And I will be your God, and you will be my people. I will forgive your evil deeds, and I will remember your sin no more. As we confess our sins, Sovereign God, in baptism you called us to turn from sin and to turn to Jesus Christ. But we stray from his ways and do not heed your call. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
In baptism, you united us with all the baptized who confess your name. But we foster division in the church. We refuse to live as one people, and so fail to witness to your reconciling love for the world. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
In baptism, you call us to ministry in all realms of life, but we refuse the struggle to know your will. We do not nurture the ways of peace. We allow enmity and hatred to grow among us, putting neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. We abuse the earth you entrust to our care and live in discord with all you made. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
In baptism, you sent us to serve with compassion all for whom Christ died. But we ignore the suffering of the oppressed and the plight of the poor. We take bread from the hungry and will not listen to the cries for justice. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy on us. Remember the promises you made to us in our baptism. Forgive our sinful ways and heal our brokenness. Set us free from all that enslaves us and raise us to new life in Jesus Christ, that we may be your faithful servants, showing forth your healing love to the world, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for having me here today on this New Year's Day in this Christmas season. I'm so grateful that we can gather together and worship God. Please join me now in the prayer for illumination. Gracious God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our minds and hearts, that as your word is read and proclaimed, we will turn to you and be your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our first reading is from Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Listen now for the word of God. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 15 through 21. Listen now for the word of God. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. And Mary treasured all these words, pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sheldon, my husband Sheldon and I have three grown sons. And when our youngest, Red, was born, our oldest was 4 years old. Sheldon Jr. was four. And we brought Ray home from the hospital. And one day soon after, as I was rocking Ray, Sheldon was having to kind of entertain himself, and he said, when is Ray going to get adopted? And I said, Sheldon, Ray's not going to get adopted. Ray's our baby. He's staying with our family. And he said, no, I think he needs to be adopted. And he just kept on. So finally I said, Sheldon, what do you think adopted means? And he said, you know, when we take him to church and they put that water on his head. And I thought, thank you, Fondren Sunday school teachers, explaining in a way even a four-year-old could understand one of the many wonderful meanings of baptism. Baptism and communion are the two sacraments in Reformed churches. What Augustine called visible signs of invisible grace. And baptism is the sacrament of initiation into the visible church. Baptism is multivalent. It has many meanings. A dying and rising with Christ, cleansing from sin, and adoption into the covenant family of faith, among other meanings. And every meaning is important. In baptism, we share in Christ's death and resurrection and are reborn in the Spirit. Water represents both a threat to life, we can't breathe underwater, and the environment from which life emerges. So as we are immersed or sprinkled with baptismal water in the triune name of God, we participate in the death and resurrection of Christ. We are reborn in God's Spirit that makes all things new. We have new identity as children of God. The reformer Martin Luther would write or say, "I am baptized," as a reminder of his identity and security when the fear of his work became overwhelming. John Calvin compared Christian baptism to the Jewish practice of circumcision and asserted that both represent God's covenant promises of love and forgiveness. Both circumcision and Christian baptism mark people as belonging to God, and both indicate a community bound in love to God and each other. In baptism, we become members of a new family and citizens of a new society. In baptism, we are marked as children of God. In today's lectionary reading from Luke, Jesus is circumcised as a mark of belonging to God's covenant community. Did I not read that last sentence?
No.
Did I read the part of Jesus being circumcised?
No.
This is a real mistake. Well, and it's interesting, y'all, because I print out from the NRSV, right? And I stopped reading where there was bold because there was a title, subtitle, that's in our scripture that wasn't in the manuscripts, of course, right? So I stopped where we always hear the story stop. And the lectionary reading today has one more sentence that I didn't read because I'm not used to hearing yet in that story and maybe didn't practice enough. But also, it looks in our, the way we read our scripture as if it's separate somehow. So let me try that again. Let me back up and let you hear the scripture one more time, including this last sentence. It's pretty important. So the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all they had seen and heard, just as it had been told them. When the eighth day came, it was time to circumcise the child. And he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. More of the word of God. Thanks be to God. So, in today's lectionary reading from Luke, as I was supposed to read it, Jesus is circumcised as a mark of belonging to God's covenant community. And he receives his name. In baptism, we are marked as God's own and receive the name of Christ. We become part of the Christian family of faith. When a minister baptizes someone, the minister says only that person's first name. Bob, or Betty, or Beatrice, I baptize you. The person's last name, his or her family name, is not included. In baptism, we are part of God's family. In today's reading from Galatians, Paul asserts that God sent God's Son so that we might receive adoption as children. This claim of adoption is central to Paul's purpose in writing his letter. Paul founded the churches in Galatia during his missionary travels, and the converts there were Gentiles, not Jews. In Galatia, Paul preached the gospel of Jesus Christ crucified as God's decisive, transformative act of salvation. The Gentile Christians accepted Paul's message of grace, were baptized, and received the Holy Spirit. Paul left these new churches confident that they were running well. But now, Paul has learned that his work in Galatia is being undermined by missionaries who have arrived in Galatia preaching a different gospel. These missionaries are preaching that Gentiles who believe in Jesus should take the next step into full covenant membership by being circumcised and following Jewish law. In his letter to the churches in Galatia, Paul addresses this perversion of the gospel. In passionate language, he asserts that Gentile converts to Christianity do not need to be circumcised or follow Jewish law to enter into the covenant family of faith. God's grace in Jesus Christ is sufficient for our salvation. In and through the person of Jesus, God saves us. God claims us as God's children. Baptism is a sign and seal of our adoption as the children of God, and there is no power in heaven, on earth, that can separate us from the love of our Heavenly Father. Let's let that sink in on the first day of 2023. We are baptized children of Almighty God, and there is no power that can separate us from the love of God. Baptism is the ultimate expression that we belong to God. It is the ultimate reminder that in life and death, each of us and all of us belong to God. Such certainty of God's love and faithfulness and of our identity as children of God is a gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit confirms our new identity. As Paul writes, because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. The Greek word Paul uses for crying or crying out is a vivid, dramatic word. According to one commentator, it's the language of ecstasy. Some commentators suggests that the word Abba was said by people who were baptized as they rose from the water in grateful acknowledgement of their new identity as children of God. So I wonder, what is the story of your baptism? Where and when were you baptized? Who baptized you? What local congregation were you baptized into, and how were you nurtured in that community? How do you live into the promises made in your baptism and in the baptism of others? If you haven't been baptized, why not? What questions or concerns do you have about Jesus, Christianity, baptism? After the responsive hymn, you're invited to remain standing to celebrate a reaffirmation of baptism. This liturgy comes from the Book of Common Worship of the Presbyterian Church, USA. And you'll probably recognize the questions, as questions also asked during baptisms and ordination of elders. Today is the first Sunday of Christmas, when we remember and celebrate that God came into the world in human flesh, in the person of Jesus Christ. That baby in the manger is the God of all creation who comes to save the world. In grateful response to God, who comes to love and save us, we reaffirm the promises we made in baptism. Like Mary, in today's passage from Luke, may we remember, may we treasure and ponder what we have experienced and heard about Christ. Like the shepherds, may we celebrate and proclaim Christ as Savior. And like the shepherds returning to the fields, may we return with joy to the work God has given us, giving thanks and praise that in Jesus, God saves and claims us as God's own. On this first day of 2023, and throughout our lives, may we remember our baptism and be thankful. Amen.
Church, the faith in which we were baptized.
trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love?
I will, with God's help.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Holy God, the source of all life, we give you thanks for your Spirit moving over the waters, creating heaven and earth. By the gift of water, you nourish and sustain us and all living things.
By flood, you washed away evil, then made an everlasting covenant with us. You led us through the sea, out of slavery, and into freedom, leading us every step of the way.
Through John, you baptized your son Jesus in the waters of the Jordan and anointed him with your Spirit. You baptize us in water and anoint us with your Spirit, making us one with Christ and with one another.
In these waters, you claim us and name us as your own. You give us new life and a purpose for living. Your Spirit empowers us to follow where you lead as we work and watch for your coming reign of justice, peace, and love.
All praise to you, most holy God, from this day to that great day when the river of life, bright as crystal, will flow through the middle of the city, and the tree of life, heavy with fruit, will bring healing to the nations, and you will be our light forever and ever. Holy One who came as a child, we pray for your children everywhere. Holy Three who patterns community, we pray for communities everywhere. Holy Three and one in three, as we remember our baptism, we pray especially for communities without clean, safe water. We pray for Jackson, for plentiful, safe water, for mutual respect and common purpose among citizens and leaders, for those in our community who suffer this day. Help us, Lord, and show us how to help each other so that we may live in justice and peace. As we remember our baptism, bless us in the work of faith that we might be truly faithful. All praise and honor and glory are yours, O Triune God, now and forever. And now, as children of God, we pray as Christ taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In gratitude to God for God's grace to us, we offer our lives and our treasure to God. If you would like to contribute to the work of Fondren Presbyterian Church, you can leave a donation in the offering plates at the back or in the front. You can mail a check to the church office, or you can donate online on our website. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, may we remember our baptism and be thankful. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.